How are they so fast? SpaceX tests Flight 8 Starship improvements. Can they prevent another debris shower? What's left before Flight 8 can launch? SpaceX's second Mechazilla at Starbase is getting even stronger. Stoke Space closes the gap. NASA auctions a moon rover. My name is Felix. Welcome to What About It? Let's dive right in. Starship updates. At Starbase, the work never slows down, and the past few days have been no exception. SpaceX's investigation into what happened during Flight 7 is likely not done yet. The clock is ticking, though, and SpaceX is facing one big problem. Whatever fixes they come up with for Ship 34, they also need to test them before the next flight. The biggest goal for Flight 8 is not to repeat what happened on Flight 7. On the night of the 4th, a test tank arrived at Massey's. It's not a new tank. It was last spotted at Massey's in early September following a series of cryogenic proof tests. After spending some time at Sanchez, it was recently transported into the Star Factory on January 22nd. Now, here comes my theory. What if Test Tank 16 has the aft section of a Block 2 Starship? After all, that part of Ship 33 caused the biggest problem during Flight 7. So this is the part of a Block 2 Starship that SpaceX is keen on testing again. The team at Starbase has been hard at work to help improve on this arguably questionable first launch of a Block 2 Starship. Test Tank 16 has already been upgraded with hardware improvements. SpaceX needs validation for its proposed fixes as fast as possible, not only for their own record, but also for the FAA. The faster a new test campaign begins validating these technical advancements, the sooner preparations for Flight 8 can move forward. Sooner is better, right? One way or another, Test Tank 16 will be put through its paces soon. That leads to the big question. What exactly will it be tested for? There are a few possibilities here. A static fire test is off the table. A test tank alone doesn't have engines. Pressure tests are the only option. On top of that, I wouldn't be surprised if the can crusher will squish Test Tank 16. Flight 7 showed that the current Block 2 thrust structure shows signs of weakness. The leak that occurred wasn't present on the ground. Otherwise, sensors would have picked up a leak during fueling. So Test Tank 16 will be the canary in the coal mine, showing SpaceX if their improvements are a solution to a more successful Flight 8. We can look forward to the first real-world results during this test campaign. SpaceX has a little shop of horrors out at the Massey's test site. While much of the focus has been on the brand new Can Crusher 2.0, SpaceX hasn't forgotten about its smaller, older counterpart either. For a time, its fate seemed unclear, but now the outer 20 pull-down rams have been reinstalled on the old Can Crusher. This means we might just witness an unexpected return to action. At night, you can hear Test Tank 16 shiver. And with test tanks silently awaiting their turn, SpaceX keeps working on its much larger, more evil Can Crusher 2.0. They've finished installing the holding arms and actuators, and it does like our mystery item has found a use case. During our January 31st flyover, we spotted some noticeable upgrades. Our mystery part is beginning to look like a disc. It has the same diameter as a Starship and its construction looks very robust. It could just be a push-up plate at the bottom of Can Crusher 2.0, the part that puts pressure on the thrust structure of a test article. We could also see a crane getting ready to lift ring-shaped structures. Thanks to Jordan, our dedicated on-site photographer, we caught the exact moment one of these segments was installed. As you can see, it fits inside the structure, forming an inner ring. With more testing on the horizon, we won't have to wait long to get a clearer picture of its exact design and purpose. Time to leave Massey's, and before we move over to the production side, our channel metrics show over 4 million returning monthly viewers who have not subscribed yet. Help improve the channel and double check that you've hit the subscribe button to stay up to date with our updates. It's free and it helps us bring you even better content. Like this video if you appreciate the content and become a Y supporter for extra content. Secure your access to up to 7 picture galleries per week, satellite, aerial and ground photos, and 3D animations, chat with me and gain more insights on the topic you love. You feel like doing something crazy? Check out redlineheli.com/felix for a once-in-a-lifetime experience and $25 off flying in a helicopter above Starbase. The Redline helicopter team is waiting for you. They'll show you the same views our photographers get on their Starbase flights. Now back to our Starbase updates. Let's take a look at the activity happening just behind the Star Factory. Follow me. Flight 8, as much as Flight 7 was going to be, is not only about Starship testing anymore. SpaceX announced its intent to deploy dummy version 3 Starlink satellites. This is very important for SpaceX, as Starships can start being actively useful for the company as soon as they can carry a payload to space. That's why all eyes are currently on this thing. It's a Starlink loader system that feeds Starlink satellites into a Starship payload bay before a launch. On the morning of the 3rd, we spotted it being moved into the high bay. A short while later, the device was hooked up to the bay's gantry crane. This system seems to be giving SpaceX more trouble than needed. Midway through the procedure, a large boom crane arrived to lend a hand. Many things are different on a Starship, including its payload integration. While other rockets receive their payload nicely packed up inside a fairing, Starships will be filled with their initial payload via this system. Arrived in space, they are supposed to deploy the Starlink satellites with a PEZ dispenser. No, not that one. This one. It's integrated into the payload bay of a Starship, can't be removed, and is highly specialized in deploying Starlink satellites exclusively. This mechanism is the dispenser assembly platform. It's used inside the Star Factory to install the actual dispensing system within Starship, positioned just behind the loading bay door. The actual dispenser consists of the outer section, 4 silver rails with a beefy mechanism at the bottom. This is a key component to keep an eye on. Eventually, this will be installed into a future Starship. Before we continue, let's talk about something fundamental. Here's the situation. Blue Origin and SpaceX have traditionally been heated topics among space enthusiasts. Everyone knows this. Is SpaceX better or Blue Origin? Public opinion largely depends on what the news say. One of the best tools to see what the broader media world is saying, and my top source for my own research for What About It, is Ground News. So let's see what we can find when researching New Glenn's first launch. There's one thing we can see at first glance. Ground News found hundreds of sources with almost no negative headlines about the launch or Bezos himself. 90% of the sources you can find speak of a glorious moment when Jeff Bezos was with his loved ones and New Glenn reached orbit on the first try. Now, let's see how the media frames SpaceX's Flight 7, which flew on the same day. That's very different. Again, hundreds of sources, but debris over the Caribbean and Starship explodes. Even a headline suggesting that the industry should not become dependent on SpaceX. You know, that's a bit off. That's the reality of media, but we can be smarter. Ground News gives us all the tools we need. They are subscriber funded, so you won't see any ads on their website contributing to sensationalism and clickbait reporting. By subscribing, you're also supporting Y directly as well. Go to ground.news/y or scan the QR code on the screen. When you use my link, you can get 40% off unlimited access, which is what I use. Try it. Thank you, Ground News. Back to Starbase. The rapid progress on the office space in general is hard to miss. SpaceX is nearing completion fast. Even though this part of the Star Factory doesn't actually handle prototypes, it's where all the thinking happens. Missions to the Moon and Mars will be planned in these offices. At Sanchez, work continues on both the flame deflector and the massive orbital launch mount for Pad B. With the top of the table now fully welded, crews have finished connecting pipes to the manifolds, which are already in place and awaiting integration. The next steps will include adding a cover for the OLM. The real question is if this thing will be a mobile launch platform or not. We'll have to wait a bit longer for more clues. Now, this next news will interest you if you ever thought of going down to Starbase to see a launch in person. Construction begins on a brand new $6.9 million pavilion on South Padre Island. You know what that means? This pavilion should offer an amazing view for watching Starship launches. The project is being funded through a collaboration between the American Rescue Plan Act, Cameron County, and, you guessed it, SpaceX. This is going to be incredible. Groundbreaking was set for February 5th, with construction expected to take between 8 and 12 months. That means we could be watching Starship launches from a brand new viewing spot by the end of the year. Speaking of launches, let's take a moment to look ahead at the upcoming Starship flight tests. What's left to do? Ship 34 successfully completed cryogenic testing on January 15th and 17th and was stationed at the production site awaiting engine installation as of its last sighting. Meanwhile, Booster 15 is currently inside Mega Bay 1, having completed its cryogenic test campaign in December. Most likely, these two will be paired together for Flight 8, which is currently set for no earlier than February 24th. So what about Flight 9? We know that Booster 14 was in significantly better shape after its catch on January 16th compared to Booster 12's return. Currently, it's back at the build site inside one of the mega bays. But is it truly ready for a reuse attempt? Now let's consider its competitor. Booster 16 is still in production though, as we mentioned earlier. It has already begun some early pre-stacking. Looking at the timeline of previous boosters, Booster 16 might not be ready for flight until August. Given the rapidly decreasing turnaround time between Starship flights, SpaceX is unlikely to wait that long if Flight 8 moves forward soon. If Booster 16 isn't finished soon or doesn't begin its extensive cryogenic testing by April, the chances of witnessing history with the first ever Starship Super Heavy booster reuse are looking stronger than ever. And with that, it's a race between Booster 14 and Booster 16 to see which one makes it to the Flight 9 launch pad first. Who's your pick to win? Let us know in the comments. Now let's take a look at Pad B, SpaceX's latest and massive addition to the launch site. One of the notable recent updates was the successful attachment of the traveling block to the Tower 2 chopsticks on February 1st, 2025. But what exactly is a traveling block? It's a crucial part of a drilling rig's hoisting system, consisting of multiple pulleys mounted within a frame and linked to the drilling hook and drill string. The system, commonly used in oil and gas drilling, has been repurposed by SpaceX to lift, lower, and catch boosters 12 and 14 as they returned from space, and countless other prototypes. However, there's been a new development with the block that's caught our attention. The traveling block on Tower 2 has received a slight design modification. Recent images show that it now features slots for 7 reeving loops instead of 5. While this adjustment will slow down the system's movement along the tower, it increases its lifting capacity. This is a significant change as SpaceX prepares for even heavier loads in the future. This update highlights the ongoing refinements of Starbase's systems to keep pace with the ever-growing demands of the Starship program. And that's not all either. Additional work has been spotted across the site, including the installation of 2 horizontal tanks in the fuel farm, along with vaporizers and heat exchangers designed to assist in pumping fuel to the tower. But fuel isn't the only thing SpaceX needs. Water is just as critical. Like the water deluge system on Pad A, Pad B requires an enormous amount of water, significantly more than its predecessor. That's because most of this water will be directed into the new flame diverter in addition to cooling Pad B's updated water-cooled launch mount. With Flight 8 fast approaching, this milestone brings us another step closer to making SpaceX's vision for interplanetary travel a reality. It also lays the groundwork for Starship's role in future missions to the Moon, Mars, and beyond. As demand for Starship and booster launches continues to rise, having multiple fully operational launch pads will be essential for supporting the high launch cadence SpaceX is aiming for. Once fully functional, Pad B will be capable of handling both the booster and the ship, ensuring Starbase operations remain efficient and scalable. Time and time again, SpaceX proves its ability to innovate at an incredible pace. With Pad B upgrades progressing and the new flame diverter nearing completion, attention is now shifting to the next big milestone, static fire tests, and ultimately the highly anticipated launch of the 8th fully integrated Starship and booster. These steps could mark the beginning of a new chapter in space exploration. If there were any doubts about SpaceX's commitment to its mission, a new addition to the headquarters makes it clear. A striking Mars globe now hangs in the main entrance lobby. This globe, with its vivid colors and detailed topography, represents SpaceX's ambitious vision for Mars exploration and future colonization. More than just decoration, it serves as a constant reminder for the company's long-term goals, inspiring both employees and visitors as they walk through the doors. Next, let's talk about full-flow staged combustion engines. Let's talk Zenith. Wait, not Raptor? You might not have heard of it, but there's another private space company building something very similar to SpaceX's Raptor engine. Stoke Space. I talked about them many times before, and with a recent successful funding round of $260 million, they are on the launch table more than ever. They are the guys with the crazy-looking bi-turbopump-fed second-stage hybrid aerospike engine. It's tough to find words for this that exist, as this concept is so different and new that it sent ripples throughout the entire space industry when it was first revealed. And the first stage of their yet-to-fly Nova rocket will be powered by Zenith, Stoke Space's very own full-flow staged combustion engine. Zenith means high point, the peak of performance, efficiency and achievement. That's how Stoke Space describes its engine. Nova's first stage will be powered by 7 of these Methalox-fueled engines. Stoke Space successfully hot-fired its first stage rocket engine on a new vertical test stand at the company's Washington facility in December in what they called a very big deal for the 4-year-old startup. They can certainly be seen as one of the most important young space companies out there. They've not launched any rockets yet, but judging by what we can already see, they certainly seem to be in it for glory. Stoke Space is a classic example of the second space race. Private companies are trying to win in an industry traditionally occupied by giants like Boeing, Northrop Grumman, or Lockheed Martin. A tough environment that can only be conquered with innovation and new technologies. Last but certainly not least, let's talk moon again. Because have you ever heard of a brand new lunar rover being auctioned off? This is Viper, a moon rover built by NASA's Johnson Space Center. It's a very versatile lunar explorer and its considerable size of 1.4 by 1.4 by 2 meters put it on my personal radar a long time ago. We know these rovers only from Mars. An entire family of rovers has been and still is exploring strange and fascinating places with incredible findings coming in from the red planet almost every month. On the moon, though, that's not the case. Large rovers have never driven on our closest neighbor in space, with the exception of the Apollo lunar rovers, of course. Some of you might already know this mission, as it was already set to fly to the moon. Astrobotic's Griffin lander, slated to launch toward the moon in 2025, was supposed to deliver it to the lunar surface. All that was cancelled because of budget concerns. After all, it was designed as a $450 million mission, not a small side project. Everything seemed grim, and golf cart-sized rovers on the moon seemed in the far future or past. Until just a few days ago, friends of golf cart-sized lunar rovers rejoice. NASA is breathing fresh wind into the mission once again. On February 3rd, NASA announced that it is seeking proposals from US companies to partner on Viper. Now, it might seem strange that NASA is seeking private partners for Viper, but there is one fact that makes this proposal a lot more sound. Viper, short for Volatiles Investigating Polar Exploration Rover, is already assembled. It's done, sitting at the Johnson Space Center, not exploring the moon at all. What NASA is trying to do here is to find a private partner willing to spend some money to bring the rover to the moon so that it can actually do science. After all, it was built for a very important task, prospecting. It was supposed to search for lunar resources in permanently shadowed areas of the lunar South Pole region, especially by mapping the distribution and concentration of water ice. This is a very important task, especially in regards to Artemis, NASA's plan to go to the moon and stay there for longer. Ice is essential for such an endeavor. Where there is water, there can be life. This is also true for the moon. Besides the obvious reason of wanting to stay hydrated, ice can be used for all sorts of other things. It can be split into oxygen and hydrogen. Oxygen for breathing and hydrogen as a fuel source, either for rockets or for industrial purposes. There won't be a base on the moon if there is no ice. Finding a suitable spot for such a base and investigating this ice is a mandatory first step before we can even think about staying there for longer. So if you know anyone who has the pocket change to send a lunar rover to the moon, please show them this video. I would love to see Viper have a chance. That's it for today. Remember to smash that like button, subscribe for more. This is what fuels the algorithm. This is how you can help us for free. Check out our epic shirts in your favorite space nerd store. A new Raptor design and our brand new Starship Block 2 design are both up. Link is in the description and in the card you should see now. Also, check out our print store at shop.whataboutit.space to buy a picture for your favorite wall. A significant amount of every purchase goes directly to our photographer. And if you want to learn more about the fascinating story of SpaceX's Raptor 3 engine, watch this video next to continue your journey. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you again in the next episode. As a starship and its construction actively begin being, start being actively useful. Successful attachment. However, I don't know.